Good morning. So today we'll be discussing about crossbar switch and multiport memory in detail. So as we have discussed before, the switched networks we talk about when we talk about the switched networks, we prefer packet switching more than circuit switching because it provides dynamic interconnections between the input and output, and also you don't have to set a path for the packet transmission. So in that case, since the dynamic behavior is provided by the packet switching method, we switch on to packet switching mode itself. Okay, then this since it is dynamic, it enables reconfiguring connection structure in the system. So based on the based on various factors, switched networks are classified. Okay, so first factor is how many stages of switching elements are there in the network. So based on that, there will be single staged and multi-stage networks. And the second one is whether there is a blocking mechanism available inside the network. If there isn't the case, then it is known as a blocked network, else it is a non-blocking network. Okay, so let's see all of this in detail now. So we have discussed about all these, the single stage network, the single stage network, crossbar network is a perfect example of a single stage network. Which means it will have to, it is also known as recirculating network because the data may have to recirculate through the single stage for a number of times to finally reach the desired output. In the single stage network, one problem is that not all input can lead to all outputs. Okay, so that is the issue associated with single stage network. So to rectify this, we have provided crossbar switches, but crossbar switches are not highly scalable. In that case, we have provided the idea of multi-stage network. Okay, so let's see more of this in detail. Okay, so in the case of multi-stage network, so you can see the difference in the figure. So this is about the single stage network. What you see here is the single stage network. Now what you see is the multi-stage network. Okay, so what you see here is the multi-stage network. As you can see, this is stage 1, this is stage 2, this is stage 3, and this is stage 4. Okay, so what is this? There are multiple stages. There are multiple stages of networks. Okay, there are multiple stages of networks. Each stage will have a so-called number of switching elements, and that is decided based on the bits. Okay, so if you are talking about a maximum of up to 8 bits, then you will have 4 switching elements per stage. If it is 15, then you will have 8 switching elements per stage. Okay, so that is decided based on the number of input bits. Okay, then that is it. So here in the multi-stage network, as I said, it is a high-speed computer network, and processing elements will be there. It is composed of processing elements on one end of the network and memory elements on the other end of the network. Okay, so that is how it is being maintained. On one end you will have all the processing elements, and on the other end of the network it will be memory modules. Okay, and they will be connected using something called switching elements. And as I said before, there will be more than one stage of switch boxes. And one good thing about multi-stage network is that using multiple stages, you can connect any input to any output. Okay, then this is actually made by cascading or putting together more than one single stage networks. Okay, so examples for this multi-stage network includes Omega network, Flip network, Baseline network, etc. So let's see what is this blocking and non-blocking networks. So when a network is said to be blocking, there will be simultaneous connections between some input or output pairs, and that will result in conflict. Okay, so when more than one input output pairs are trying to work at the same time, or when the same output is being accessed by more than one input, in that case, at some point during the transmission, there will be a chance that they have to pass through a common switching element, and that results in conflict. Okay, so if simultaneous connections of some multiple input output pairs results in a conflict, then one of them will be provided access and the other one will be blocked. If that is the behavior of the network, then such kind of a network is known as a blocking network. If this can be avoided, which means one of them will be provided the way and the other one will be given some other ways to reach the output, in that case it is known as a non-blocking network. Okay, so a network is called blocking if simultaneous connections of some multiple input output pairs results in conflicts of the communication link, and you will have to ask one of them to wait and it will have to undergo multiple passes through the networks to achieve certain connections. Our Omega network, baseline network, Banyan networks, etc. are examples of blocking networks. Whereas in the case of non-blocking network, when a conflict occurs, it will try to identify another way out so that both the requests can be satisfied at the same time. That is, it will rearrange its connections. Okay. So, Bennes networks, Clouse networks, etc. are examples of non-blocking networks. Now, let's see about crossbar network in detail. Okay, so about crossbar network, it is a single stage network as we have discussed before, and it will be using crossbar switches. Okay, all the switches are unary switches, which means it will satisfy one connection. Okay, so they are unary switches, and that particular thing is known as cross point. So each cross point between a processing element and memory will be implemented using a unary switch, that is a crossbar switch. Okay, so every input port is connected to a free output port through a cross point switch without blocking. Okay, so we can say that the crossbar network is a single stage network and a non-blocking network, because it will find out some other arrangements to reach the corresponding destination. So that is why this is known as a single stage non-blocking permutation network. Okay, so I'll show you a pictorial representation of crossbar switch. So this is a crossbar switch. On one side what you see is the memory module, and on the other side what you see is the processing element. Okay, so between each memory module and processing element pair there is something called a switch, and that switch is a crossbar switch. Okay, so this switch enables the connection between a processing element and the memory module. So the cross point switch, they are known as cross point switch, and it is a unary switch which can have two states, either open or closed. Okay, so this switch, so whenever there is a connection or whenever there is a transmission of data between the memory or to the processing element, that corresponding unary switch goes to the closed state and the data will be transmitted, else it will remain open. Okay. So cross point switch, as I said, so they provide dynamic interconnections between source and destination pairs. So in this case, it is between processing elements and memory modules. Okay, then the path will be dedicated between the pair. Okay, so this is about the crossbar switches, the cross point switches. Okay, so what you see here in this figure is a 16 by 16 crossbar network, which means you have 16 processing element modules and 16 memory modules. Okay, so in this case you have 16 processors, 16 memory modules. Each of the processor memory pair will have a dedicated cross point. Okay, then each memory module can satisfy only one processor request at a time. Okay, so a particular memory module will be accessed, will give access to only one processing element at a time, whereas multiple processing elements can access, or the 16 memory modules, the 16 different memory modules can be accessed by the 16 different processing elements at the same time. There is no problem. But if the same memory module is being asked to access by two different processing elements, only one of them will be satisfied. The other one will have to identify some other path to reach the destination. Okay, so problem arises when multiple requests arrive at the same memory module at the same time. In that case, only one will be given and the other one will have to identify some other permutation or some other rearrangement to reach the destination. So that is about cross point switches. Now we'll see the design of a cross point switch, or what is inside a cross point switch. Okay, so an n by n crossbar network will require n square sets of cross point switches. Okay, remember, an n by n crossbar network, which means n processing elements, n memory modules. An n by n crossbar network will require n square sets of crosspoint switches. And each of these crosspoint switches will have a whole lot of address lines, data lines, control lines and so on. So a large number of lines are also associated with this, which means the hardware associated with a crossbar network is too huge or too dense. Okay, so this will restrict the crossbar network from expanding beyond a limit. Okay, so if n is going to have a sufficiently larger value, you will have to increase the number of crosspoint switches exponentially, which means you will have to find the square of that much crosspoint switches, and then you will have to spend a whole lot of lines inside the network. Okay, this will not only increase the complexity of the network but also degrade the performance. Okay, so that is the disadvantage of having crossbar. It is not properly scalable beyond a limit. Okay, so the maximum size that can be accommodated in the crossbar network is n less than or equal to 60. So this is what it is inside a crosspoint switch. Okay, so a crosspoint switch, you can see the multiple crosspoint switches are connected simultaneously on each row. Each processor will be sending independent requests. There is an arbitration logic. Yeah, you can see it here. This is the arbitration logic. The arbitration logic is responsible to identify which of the simultaneous requests to a particular memory module should be satisfied. Okay, if two processing elements P1 and P2 are trying to access the same memory module, then the arbitration logic will decide on which of P1 and P2 should be given the access and which one should not be. And that is done by the arbitration logic. Okay, and it has got some priority rules to decide all these. And acknowledgement signals are used to indicate the result of arbitration. If the result is a positive thing, then it will be acknowledged as positive. If it is not, then it will be acknowledged as negative. Okay, so that is done. So you can see the arbitration logic. All the processing elements have got a connection with the arbitration logic. Similarly, all the processors also have got a connection with the multiplexer module also. Okay, so the arbitration logic will receive the request and will give the acknowledgement, whether it be positive or negative. Okay, so this arbitration logic will help to avoid data conflicts or avoid conflicts. Okay, so the signals initiate data transfer, and arbitration logic will have some priority, and based on that priority, one of the requests to a common memory module will be given and the other one will be discarded. Okay, now the second part of it is the multiplexer module, which you can see here. The multiplexer module, it has got a data bus, address bus and a read write control signal. So again, on the left side of it, on the right side of it, you can see the processing element. So multiplexer unit is used to decide on one of the n read or write requests. Okay, so that is being decided, or that is being selected using the multiplexer module. So there, as I said before, there are n sets of data, address and read or write lines which is connected to the input of multiplexer tree. Okay, so there are n processors. Each of them will have their own read lines, their own read or write lines, and their own data and address lines. Okay, so based on these, each of them will be having their own copies of these three signal lines, and it will be given in the input part of the multiplexer. In the output part, based on the control signal received, okay, based on the control signal received, then only one of these n sets will be given the access. Okay, will be selected by the multiplex tree. Okay, and the memory address is entered for both read and write accesses. When read, the data is fetched from the memory, is returned to the selected processor using the data path, which means if it was a read request, the data path will be used to get the data and it will be passed to the corresponding processor. If it was a write, then the data will be taken from the processor through the read, through its read write line, and that will be given to the memory through the data bus of multiplexer, which is on the left side. Okay, so yeah, you can see this figure for your better understanding. So there are n sets of data, address and read write signals, okay, corresponding one set corresponding to one processor, that is in the input of multiplexer module. There is a control signal that comes from the arbitration logic. So the arbitration logic will select which of the request to be answered, and that correspondingly will be given to the multiplexer module, and the multiplexer module will take that particular content, okay, so that signal, based on the control signal received, out of these n sets only one set will be activated, and if it is a read request, then this will be taken from the shared memory module. The corresponding data will be taken through the data bus and passed to the corresponding processing element. If it was a write, then it will be taken, data will be taken from the read write, from the read write signal here, from the data bus here, it will be taken and it will be passed to the shared memory module. So this is how it works. Now we'll see the schematic design of a row of cross point switch in a crossbar network. So as I said, this is already discussed. The multiplexer module is going to select it, and it will be the data bus and address bus along with the read write control signal will initiate the process. Yeah, as I said, there are some advantages and disadvantages for a crossbar. Advantage is that it is single stage. You don't have to add too many stages of switching elements. It is single stage and it is non-blocking. You don't have too many conflicts coming in. So that is the advantage. Okay, so a single processor can send many requests to multiple memory modules, because each it has got individual connections to all the memory modules, so it can send multiple requests to all the memory modules, and n memory words can be delivered to n processors in each cycle, and it has got highest level of bandwidth. Disadvantage is, as I said before, each of the cross point switch has got data, address and signal lines. And if you have n by n network, you will have to have n square cross point switches. So this makes the hardware too complex. So that is one disadvantage, and it will be also expensive if you are going to enlarge the size of the network. Okay, and it is not properly scalable also. Okay, so it is cost effective only for small multiprocessors with very few processors and few memory modules. Now let's talk about multi-port memory. So as the name says, here there will be multiple units of memory, and each of the memory will have multiple ports on it. Okay, so there will be multiple units of memory, there will be multiple modules of memory. Each of the memory will be a multi-ported memory, which means it can directly connect with more than one processing elements. Okay, so this is used by mainframe multiprocessors. So we'll see the pictorial representation later. So let's see that. Now all the cross point arbitration and switching function associated with each memory modules will be taken care by a memory controller. Then the memory module has become more expensive, because in this case, in the case of multi-port memory, each of the memory module has got multiple ports, multiple access ports, and that makes this particular type of memory more expensive compared to the normal one. Okay, so there will be n switches tied to the n input port of the memory module. One process, but even if it has got multiple ports, only one of them will be satisfied. Okay, even if there are n processing elements being connected to a particular memory module, you cannot satisfy all of them at the same time. Okay, so only one of the n processing modules or n processing requests will be satisfied. Okay, then this helps to resolve the conflicts among the processors. So this is how a multi-port memory looks. Okay, so it is in a way similar to the cross point switch design, because each of the memory module is directly connected with each of the processing elements. But the so here you can see this is a 3x3 multiport memory. Okay, so here you can see three processing elements. There are three memory modules. Each of them has got multiple ports. Okay, so here you can see there are multiple ports. There are n ports. Okay, it can be three. It can be, sorry, there are n processing elements here. So there are n memory modules also. Okay, then each of them have got n ports. So each of the processor is connected with a particular memory module through a dedicated port. But the memory module will be serving only one a request at the same time. Okay, so this is it. All the cross point arbitration and switching functions are moved to the memory controller. So this is how it looks. Okay, so the multiport memory is going to decide, or multiport memory is going to resolve the conflicts among the processors. Okay, there will not be anyone else to resolve the conflict. It is done by the multiport memory itself. Now, what is the drawback? So the drawback is that the memory structure has become more expensive. Initially, the memory module was a simple or normal memory module. It has got a normal memory module, and you were using some external cross points to connect between the processing elements and the memory module. Now the connection has happened inside the memory module itself, and that has made the memory more expensive. It is not scalable. After beyond a certain limit, you cannot scale it. Then if you have a large number of memory module, you will have to spend a large number of interconnection cables. Just like we had it in crossbar network, you have to spend a large number of interconnection cables, connectors, etc. So this restricts the scalability of the network. Now we'll see. So that's all about the single stage network. We have discussed about multi-port as well as crossbar network. So both has got its own advantages and disadvantages. So they were both of single stage network. Now we are going to discuss about multi-stage network. Okay, so multi-stage network, primarily focusing on Omega network, we'll have a discussion on multi-stage network. So as we have discussed before, there will be multiple units of, or multiple stages of networks. Each stage will be a single stage network, and they will be combined together or cascaded together to form a multi-stage network. So it is used to build a large microprocessor system. Then examples are Omega network, Butterfly network, etc. Combining networks are a special class of multi-stage network, and it is used to resolve access conflicts automatically within the network. Okay, then it was first invented in NYU Ultra Computer. Yeah, talking about Omega network, we'll discuss about the theory portion of Omega network today, and maybe in the next class we'll have a hands-on on how to design a Omega network. Okay, so about Omega network, each of the stages, there can be n number of stages. Each stage you will have so many switching elements, and the switching elements, each of them will be a 2x2 switch, which means 2 input, 2 output. Okay, 2x2 switches. So an n input Omega network will have log n to the base 2 stages. Okay, so if you are talking about an n input Omega network, then you should have log n to the base 2. Okay, so if you have for example, if you are talking about 8, okay, there is an 8 input, you have to get 8 inputs. In that case, there should be 3 stages, because log 8 to the base 2 is 3. Okay, so that is about stages. Okay, so when we design it, you will have to take into consideration how many inputs are there. Based on the number of inputs, you have to apply logarithm on that number to get what is the number of stages required. Okay, each stage will then require n/2 switch modules, because you are going to apply a 2x2 network, right? So if you want n inputs, then you should have n/2 switching elements. So in each stage, if you have 8 inputs, 8/2, you should have 4 switching elements per stage. 4 switching elements per stage. Okay, then each switch module will be individually controlled. There are 4 possible connections between the switches. Inside the switches, between input and output, you can have 4 possible connections. Okay, the straight connection. Straight connection is that you have 2 inputs. Okay, a higher input and a lower input. The lower input will be connected to the lower output. The higher input will be connected to the higher output. That is straight connection. Crossover connection, the lower input will be connected to the higher output. The higher input will be connected to the lower output. That is crossover connection. Upper broadcast is that both the inputs will be given to the higher output. Lower broadcast is that both the input will be given to the lower output. Okay, I'll repeat once again. There are four connections that can be done between the inputs and outputs of a 2x2 switch. Okay, taking a single switch. Okay, you have got, just draw a box. You have two inputs, two outputs. Okay, on the left side you have input, on the right side you have output. Now, when you talk about a straight connection, it is that the lower output, the lower input will be directly connected to the lower output. Higher input will be directly connected to the higher output. Crossover connection, it is just that the lower input will be connected to the higher output. The higher input will be connected to the lower output. Upper broadcast, both the inputs will be connected to the higher output. Lower broadcast, both the inputs will be connected to the lower output. So this is how the connections that can happen inside the 2x2 switches. Now, about another thing, this is about the primary connection that has to be established between the switching elements of the network or between the stages. Okay, so taking here is an example where you have got 8 inputs. So the first input will be 0, the last input will be 7. Okay, 8 inputs. The first input will be 0, represented as 0, 0, 0, and the last input will be 7, represented as 1, 1, 1. Okay, last input. So you will have 8 inputs. You should have 4 switching elements per stage, and you should have 3 stages. Okay, now you have 4 switching elements, right? 4 stages, 4 switching elements, and 3 stages. Okay, so our input, okay, the primary, this is about the primary connection, not the original connection, the primary connection with which you can design an Omega network. You are going to apply the principle of rotate left. Okay, you have learned rotate left, rotate right, then shifting, shift left, shift right, so and so in logic system design. Okay, so we are just recollecting that. Okay, so the first connection, your input is 000, you are going to shift it again, you get 000. It is not shifting, it is rotate. Okay, so rotating to the left, it is 000 again. So what happens, you are directly drawing from 000, you give the input at one end of the switching element, it is 000, you are taking the output from the other element, which is again 0. Okay, the output is from the other end, and that is again 0. So this in the case of a network, I'll show you the figure here. So here you can see it is 0, it is directly connected to the 0 itself, because how many times, even if you repeat it for 1000 times, you can see that it is not going to change. Okay, so that is why the 0, this is input, this is output. Okay, this is input, this is output. Now 0 is directly connected, it comes here, this is the input, this is the output. This is the input, this is the output. This is the input and this is the output. This is about the primary connection. When you talk about 1, it is 001, right? In the first case, it is here, okay? 001, it will be rotated left, so it becomes 010. What is 010? It is 2. So this is directly, this is the input part, it is directly connected to 2, okay? Now you are going to shift it again. What happens? It becomes 100. What is 100? 100 is this one, which is 4. Okay, so from the output, it is directly taken to 4 of the second stage. 4 of the second stage. In the first stage, it is connected to 2. In this second stage, it is getting connected to 4. Okay, now what happens? You shift it again. It becomes 001. So what is that? 001 is 1 of the other output. Okay, so you take it that way. Okay, inside the connection, whether it be crossover, whether it be upper broadcast, lower broadcast, that will be decided based on the input and output pattern. Okay, that I'll tell you later while we are actually designing the network. This is about the basics of Omega network. Similarly, when you talk about 2, initially it is 0, 1, 0. You shift it, rotate left, it becomes 1, 0, 0. What is 1, 0, 0? It is 4. So from 2, it is directly connected to the 4 input port number 4. Okay, this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So 2 is directly connected to 4. Shift it again, it becomes 1. 001. So what is 001? It is 1. In the second stage, it is given to the input port number 1. Okay, so it becomes 001. Now rotate left, it becomes 010, that is 2. So from here it goes like this and comes here. This is applied for all the other pin numbers. Okay, so what you have to do is that just initially copy the switching elements. Okay, now you can even apply this for 15 inputs. Okay, try doing it for 15 inputs and find out. So if it is 15 inputs or what you say the 16 inputs, then you should have 16 divided by 2, 8 switching elements per stage. And how many stages do you need? Log of 16. What is log of 16? It is 4. So 4 stages, 8 switching elements per stage. So try to draw that network and identify how the connections can be done. Okay, so in the first case it will be 0000, the next input will be 0001, and so on. In the end it will be 1111. Try to draw that network, and after that we'll see how to really design an Omega network. So this is all about the basics of Omega network, the primary thing that has to be done. After that, we'll see how to design an Omega network for real. Okay, so thank you. That's all for today.